You are listening to The Life of Jesus Christ in a Year from the Visions of Anne Catherine Emmerich from TAN. I'm Father Edward Looney, and each day I will be reading and offering commentary to guide you through Anne Catherine Emmerich's magnificent mystical revelations. In addition to listening, you can follow along with the four-volume hardcover set of The Life of Jesus Christ and Biblical Revelations available from TAN. Before we get to today's reading, though, let us ask the intercession of our venerable author. O blessed Anne Catherine Emmerich, devout and pious follower of Christ, who patiently endured the frailty of this mortal condition, who humbly received the honorable marks of Christ Jesus on your hands, feet, side, head, and chest, the marks which you were blessed by the Lord to witness for yourself in his own sufferings, we graciously ask for your intercession with God, that we sinners may be forgiven of our sins and be drawn more completely into spiritual communion with Christ our Lord and our Savior. We ask this in the name of the Most Holy Lamb of God, through the intercession of Holy Mary, our Mother. Amen. Today is day number 158, and in this episode, we will continue reading from Volume 3. Today, we'll read number 10, John the Baptist's Message to the Synagogue, The Miraculous Draught of Fish. 10. Several of John's disciples sent by their master came from Miraculous to Capernaum before the Sabbath began. They were some of the oldest and most confidential of his disciples, and among them were the brothers of Mary Cleophas, James, Sadduc, and Heliakim. They called the elders and the committee appointed by the Pharisees into the porch before the synagogue, and there presented to them a long, narrow, conical roll of parchment. It was a letter from John, and contained in strong and expressive terms his testimony of Jesus. While they were reading it and somewhat perplexed, were discussing its contents among themselves, a numerous crowd assembled to whom the messengers from John made known what their master had at Miraculous declared in a magnificent discourse before Herod, his own disciples, and a crowded audience. I saw the whole scene. When the disciples, whom John sent to Jesus at Megiddo, had returned to their master, bringing with him the news of Jesus' miracles and teachings, as well as the persecution he endured from the Pharisees, when they repeated the various rumors afloat concerning Jesus and the complaints of many because he made no effort to release him, John the Baptist, felt himself urged once more to bear public witness to him. This he did the more readily, since all his efforts to induce him to testify of himself had been fruitless. Therefore, he sent a request to Herod to allow him to address his disciples and all others who might desire to hear him. He brought forward as a plea in his own favor that he should soon be reduced to silence. Herod did not hesitate to grant the favor asked. John's disciples and a crowd of people were admitted to the open square of the castle, in which the precursor was confined. Herod and his wicked wife sat on elevated seats, surrounded by a numerous guard of soldiers. Then John was led forth from his prison, and he began his discourse. Herod was quite pleased that the affair should come off, as he was glad of the opportunity to appease the people by letting them see how light and easy was the imprisonment to which John was subjected. Under the powerful inspiration of the Holy Ghost, the Baptist spoke of Jesus. He himself, he said, was sent only to prepare the ways for him. He had never announced another than Jesus, but stubborn as they were, the people would not acknowledge him. Had they then forgotten, he asked, what he had told them of him? He would recall it to them clearly once more, for his own end was not far distant. At these last words, the whole assembly was moved, and many of John's disciples wept. Herod grew uneasy and embarrassed, for he had by no means resolved upon John's death, while his concubine dissembled her feelings as best she could. John continued zealously to speak. He recounted the wonders that took place at Jesus' baptism and declared him the beloved Son of God announced by the prophets. His doctrine was the same as his father's. What he did, the Father also did, and no one can go to the Father excepting by him, that is, by Jesus. And so he went on, refuting at length the reproaches of the Pharisees against him, and especially that of his healing on the Sabbath day. Everyone, he said, should keep holy the Sabbath. But the Pharisees profaned it, since they did not follow the teachings of Jesus, the teachings of the Son of Him, who had instituted the Sabbath. John said many things of a similar nature, and proclaimed Jesus the one outside of whom no salvation could be found. Whoever believed not in him and followed not his doctrine would be condemned. He exhorted his disciples to turn to Jesus, not to remain standing blindly near him on the threshold, but to enter into the temple itself. After his discourse, John sent several of his disciples with a letter to the synagogue of Capernaum. In it, he repeated all that he had said in testimony of Jesus, namely, that he was the Son of God and the fulfillment of the promise, and that all his acts and teachings were right and holy. He refuted their objections, threatened them with God's judgments, and earnestly entreated them not to turn away from salvation. He commanded the disciples to read to the people another letter containing the same things, and to repeat to them all that he had just said. And now I saw John's disciples doing in Capernaum what had been commanded them. An unusually large crowd was assembled, for the city was actually swarming with people on the Sabbath. There were here Jews from all quarters, and they listened with great joy to John's testimony for Jesus. Many gave utterance to loud acclamations, and their faith gained new strength. The Pharisees had to give way to the multitude. They could not say a word. They shrugged their shoulders, shook their heads, and feigned to be well disposed. They, however, asserted their own authority and told John's disciples that they would place no obstacle in Jesus' way if he refrained from violating the laws and disturbing the public peace. He was, it was true, very wonderfully endowed, but it was theirs to maintain order, and there should be moderation in all things. John, too, was a good man, but shut up as he was in prison, he might easily form a wrong estimate of things. Besides, he had never been much with Jesus. And now the hour for the Sabbath struck, and all betook themselves to the synagogue among them. Jesus and the disciples all listened with the greatest admiration to Jesus' words. He spoke of Joseph, sold by his brethren, and explained some passages from Amos that contained the menaces of God against the prevarications of Israel. No one interrupted him. The Pharisees listened with secret envy and astonishment that they could not repress. John's testimony, proclaimed so boldly to the public, had somewhat intimidated them. But suddenly, there arose fearful cries in the synagogue. Some people had brought in a man violently possessed, belonging to Capernaum. All of a sudden, he made an assault on those around him and attempted to tear them with his teeth. Jesus turned to the side once the noise proceeded and said, "Silence! Take him!" The man became perfectly calm. They led him out of the synagogue and he threw himself on the ground, looking quite intimidated. When Jesus had finished the Sabbath instructions and was about to withdraw, he went to where the man was lying and delivered him from the devil. After that, he repaired with the disciples to Peter's near the lake, because there he could be more at peace. That night, he went off by himself to pray. Among all those that Jesus cured, I never saw any such as we call insane. They were all demoniacs and possessed. The Pharisees were still together. They ran through all kinds of ancient writings relative to the prophets, their manner of life, their teachings, and their actions. They dwelt especially on Malachias, son of whom many traditions were still extant, and compared what they found with the doctrine of Jesus. They were obliged to give Jesus the preference and admire his gifts, though they continued to criticize his teachings. Next morning, Jesus again taught in the synagogue before an immense crowd. Meanwhile, Mary Cleophas had become so sick that the Blessed Virgin sent to Jesus to implore his help. Jesus then went to Peter's near the city where Mary, the widow of Nain, and the sons and the brothers of the sick women were. The sorrow of little Simeon then, about 8 years old, was quite remarkable. He was the youngest son of Mary Cleophas, by her third husband, Jonas. Jonas was the young brother of Peter's father-in-law, who had been associated with him in the fishery, and who had died about half a year previously. Jesus went to the sick woman's bed, prayed, and laid his hands upon her. She was quite exhausted by fever. Then he grasped her by the hand and told her that she should no longer be sick. He directed them to give her to eat, and I saw them bringing her a cup of something, after which she had to eat a little. This he ordered to almost all the sick whom he cured, and I heard that it bore some significance to the most blessed sacrament. As a general thing, Jesus blessed the food thus ordered. The joy of her sons, and especially that of little Simeon, was indescribable. When their mother arose, cured, and began to serve the other sick. As for Jesus, he went out immediately, and it began to cure the crowds of the sick awaiting his coming in the sheds and the buildings around the house. The sick of all kinds were gathered here, some of long duration looked upon as incurable, others apparently at the point of death. They had been brought from far and wide. Some were even from Nazareth and had known Jesus in his early youth. I saw some carried to him on the shoulders of others, looking more like corpses than creatures with life. Some of John's disciples, they had brought the writings, came here to Jesus to amuse themselves and tell him how indignant they were against him, because he made no effort to deliver their master from imprisonment. They told him how rigorously they had fasted to obtain that God would move him to free their master. Jesus comforted them and again praised John as the holiest of men. After that, I heard them speaking with Jesus' disciples. They inquired why Jesus did not himself baptize. Their master, as they said, labored so zealously in that way. The disciples of Jesus answered in words like these: John baptized because he is the Baptist, but Jesus heals because he is the Savior, adding that John had never effected a miraculous cure. And now they came to Jesus, some scribes from Nazareth. They were very courteous and besought him once more to visit Nazareth. It looked as if they wanted to make him forget what had happened there. But Jesus replied that no prophet is esteemed in his own native city. He went then to the synagogue where he delivered the Sabbath instruction till its close. On leaving the synagogue, he cured a blind man. Peter's wife presided over the domestic affairs of his house outside the city, while those of the others near the lake were directed by his mother-in-law and stepdaughter. Jesus went away to pray. Some of the disciples, they that had formerly been engaged in fishing, asked and obtained their master's permission to go on board their barks and pass the night at their old occupation. Since there was great need of fish to supply the stupendous multitude of strangers then present in Capernaum, there were also many desirous of crossing to the other side of the lake. The disciples spent the whole night in fishing, and next morning rowed many passengers across. Jesus, meanwhile, with the rest of the disciples, busied himself in distributing alms to the poor, to the sick that had been cured, and to the needy travelers. The distribution was accompanied by instruction. With his own hands, Jesus presented to each one that of which he had need, giving him at the same time words of consolation and advice. The alms consisted of clothing, various materials and covers, bread and money. The holy women also gave alms from their own stock of provisions, as well as from the gifts bestowed upon them by certain benevolent persons. The disciples carried the bread and clothing in baskets and made the distribution of them according to Jesus' orders. Later in the day, Jesus gave at Peter's fishery a discourse, which was attended by an immense crowd. The boats of Peter and Zebedee were lying not far from the shore. The disciples who had been fishing that night before were on the shore a little distant from the crowd, busy cleaning their nets. Jesus' little bark was lying near the larger ones. When the press became too great, for the level shore was very narrow at this point, a rocky mountain wall rising in the rear, Jesus made a sign of the fishermen, and they rowed his bark to where he was standing. While it was approaching, a scribe from Nazareth, who had come hither with some of the sick whom Jesus had cured yesterday, said, "Master, I will follow thee whithersoever thou goest." Jesus replied, "The foxes have holes, and the birds of the air nests, but the Son of Man has not anywhere to lay his head." The little bark pushed up to the shore, and Jesus entered it with some of his disciples. They rowed out a short distance from the land and then up and down, pausing sometimes here and sometimes there while Jesus instructed the crowds on the shore. He related to them several parables of the kingdom of God, among them that in which the kingdom of heaven is compared to a net cast into the sea, and that of the enemy who sowed cockle among the wheat. Evening was now closing. Jesus told Peter to row his boat out on the lake, and then to cast his nets to the fish. Peter, slightly vexed, replied, "We have labored all night, and have taken nothing. But at thy word I will let down the net." And he with the others entered their barks with their nets and rowed out on the lake. Jesus bade adieu to the crowds and in his own little boat, wherein were Saturnin, Veronica's son, who had arrived the day before, and some of the other disciples. He followed after Peter's. He continued to instruct them, explaining similitudes, and when out on the deep water, told them where to let down the nets. Then he left them and rowed over in his little boat to the landing place near Matthew's. By this time, it was night, and on the edge of the boats near the nets, torches were blazing. The fishers cast out the net and rowed toward Chorazin, but soon they were unable to raise it. When at last, continuing to row eastward, they dragged it out of the deep into shallow water. It was so heavy that it gave way here and there. They inserted scoops, formed like little boats into the nets, seized the fish with their hands, and put them into smaller nets and into the casks that floated at the sides of their barks. Then they called to their companions on Zebedee's boat, who came and emptied a part of the net. They were actually terrified at the sight of the draught of fishes. Never before had such a thing happened to them. Peter was confounded. He felt how vain were all their cares, had hitherto bestowed upon their fishing, how fruitlessly they had labored, notwithstanding their trouble, and here at a word from him, they had caught at one draught more than they had ever done in months together. When the net was relieved of part of its weight, they rowed to the shore, dragged it out of the water, and gazed awestruck at the multitude of fish it still contained. Jesus was standing on the shore. Peter, humbled and confused, fell at his feet and said, "Lord, depart from me, for I am a sinful man." But Jesus said, "Fear not, Peter. From henceforth thou shalt catch men." Peter, however, was quite overcome by sadness at the sight of his own unworthiness and vain solicitude for the things of this life. It was now between 3 and 4 in the morning, and it began to grow light. The disciples, having put the fish into a place of safety, retired to their boats for a short sleep. Jesus, with Saturnin and Veronica's son, turned off to the east and climbed the northern end of the mountain ridge, upon whose southern extremity stood Gamala. Little hills and thickets were here scattered around. Jesus instructed Saturnin and Veronica's son how to pray and gave them several points upon which to reflect. Then he withdrew from them into solitude, while they rested, walked about, and prayed. The disciples spent the next day in transporting their fish, a great portion of which was distributed to the poor, and to all they recounted the wonderful circumstances attending their labor. The pagans bought a great many, and many and more were taken to Capernaum and Bethsaida. All were now firmly convinced of the folly of solitude for the nourishment of the body, for as the sea obeyed Jesus in the time of tempest, so did the fish obey him. They were caught at his word. Toward evening, they went again to the landing place on the east side of the lake, and Jesus, with the two disciples, went with them toward Capernaum. He repaired to Peter's house outside the city, and there, until after night, he cured by the light of many torches the sick, men and women, who were quite abandoned on account of their maladies, which were considered unclean. Their friends had not dared to bring them openly with the other sick. Jesus cured them secretly by night in Peter's yard. There were some among them who for years had been separated from their friends, and who were in a most pitiable condition. All the rest of the night Jesus spent in prayer. This concludes our reading today, and now we reflect on what we have just listened to, what we have just read. We hear a little bit today about John the Baptist, and soon this will be the end of John the Baptist. This is all leading us kind of to the culmination of his martyrdom, where John the Baptist confronts Herod and then is ultimately put to death. John zealously spoke. He wasn't afraid of the truth. He continued to defend Jesus and help, wanted people to realize who Jesus was. He kept pointing to Jesus. He believed everything about Jesus and wanted others to believe and to know these things too. As our reading goes on today, we hear that some of the people criticize the teachings of Jesus. It happens today in the church, doesn't it? People criticize what the church teaches, what the church believes. Some people criticize what the Lord God taught while here on earth. Are you guilty at times of criticizing the church or the teachings of Jesus? We get another reference in our reading today about Mary sending word to Jesus. The Blessed Virgin sent to Jesus to implore his help. Jesus then went to Peter's near the city where Mary, the widow of Nain, and so forth. But we see the intervention of Mary so often in our readings. Helps us to understand the great significance she plays in our life and in the life of the church. How interesting, too, as we heard today, that when Jesus heals, and we know this, too, like this wasn't mentioned in the reading today, but we know from other healings, when Jesus heals, he forgives sin. But another thing, when Jesus heals, he tells someone, go get them something to eat. And so if we think about it, in the liturgy of the church, when someone is anointed, healing graces are bestowed, and then what do? Well, we give them something to eat. We give them the Holy Eucharist. She makes a kind of a similar parallel. She says, I heard that it bore some signification to the most blessed sacrament. There's a Eucharistic connection here. We also heard, the sick of all kinds were gathered here, some of long duration looked upon as incurable, others apparently at the point of death. If you ever want to see an image of this, go to Lourdes. See the procession in the evening. See the sick being processed around who want to receive a healing through the intercession of Our Lady. Our Lady who really is obtaining this grace of healing in our reading today too. What an interesting parallel, too, we heard today. John baptized because he is the Baptist, but Jesus heals because he's the Savior. Think about that. Roles and identity, purposes and mission. And then notice, too, Jesus went away to pray. Have you ever stepped away from something to pray? In a piece I wrote, I shared about a priest from my diocese, Father Tony Dolsky. And I remember this being said at his funeral. Someone giving a eulogy said that when Father Tony would come to gatherings, sometimes you would find that he stepped away and he would pray his breviary. Everybody might be in the dining room, he goes and prays the breviary. Everybody outside gathered around a fire, he's maybe off in a corner saying his prayers. Have you ever stepped away to pray? And then these fishermen want to go out and fish. They ask permission of Jesus. I think it's noble what they want to do. They're asking Jesus, hey, you bring in a lot of people and you're putting a lot of strain on this community to feed these visitors and these people. And so we have to go fish so that we can feed them and we can help this local economy in that sense. I never thought about it like that before. It made sense as I read it here today. And then they are struck with this drought of fish. They want to do a good deed, but God isn't allowing them to fulfill that good deed. And so Jesus comes, and they are embarrassed because Jesus says, well, here, cast your net, and they catch all of these fish. It says here, never before had such a thing happened to them. Peter was confounded. He felt how vain were all the cares that had hitherto bestowed upon their fishing, how fruitlessly they labored. They're professional fishermen. They didn't catch anything. That's never happened to them before, but Jesus comes and they catch the most miraculous catch of fish. But remember, everything in the ministry of Jesus has a purpose. He uses everything, directs everything for his purposes. This is the God who confounds. This is the God who amazes. This is the Son of God who has the power to heal you and me if we approach with faith. This brings us to a close of our reading and reflection for today. Please be sure to subscribe to the podcast and sign up for email notifications at emmerichpodcast.com and use coupon code ACE25 for 25% off your next order at tanbooks.com. Please share this podcast with others. Share it with your family, text it to your friends, send a message out to your prayer group, let them know you're listening, and encourage them to join you so that you can have holy conversations with them about these writings of Anne Catherine Emmerich. I hope you'll join us next time as we continue meditating on the life of Jesus Christ with the help of Blessed Anne Catherine Emmerich. Until then, may God bless you, and Mary pray for you.